Chilling Tales for Dark Nights. Fog Lights by Jeremiah Huffman. Narration, production, and sound design by Jesse Cornett. Original score by Brandon Boone. Gormley ran a stubby finger across his lips. They were leathery and cracked. He'd had nothing to eat the previous day but coffee and sweets, and he'd been up all night writing. His tongue fell furry in his mouth, like the tail of some anxious little animal hiding in the dark hollow of a rotting stump. He was staring out the single window of the kitchenette at the back of his trailer, eyes fixed upon the mailbox, which seemed miles away, standing alone in the early morning fog. Soon the postman would show up, and once again unwittingly play Gormley's harbinger of doom. The thought made the fat little man smile, and his lower lip split down the center. A small bead of red bubbled from the slit, and Gormley raked it into his mouth with square yellowed dentures. He took another swig of his coffee and got up to pace the floor. The postman was a bit late. Perhaps it was the fog. Gormley himself couldn't recognize much outside his window. The blacktop road that led back to town appeared to have drowned in the murk. The dry brambles of the thicket occasionally revealed their twisting, jagged tips as the fog slithered through the spaces between the branches. The gloom emanated from the woods outside as if exhaled by the ancient, wicked lungs of some unseen demon. Gormley wanted to step out and look toward town to see if he could see any approaching fog lights, but he knew he'd be wasting his time. He sat back down at his shabby little table and unwrapped his last peppermint candy. He looked at the disorganized stacks of paper in front of him, printed photos of children, photos from yearbooks, sports teams, vacations, all of them emblazoned with the same word in thick, bold lettering. The word missing. Gormley perused the photos as if he were picking out a steak at a butcher shop. He would pick up each photo and study it. He'd read the accompanied information, and he would deliberate. His criteria weren't strict. Mostly, he based his decision on how happy the child looked in the picture. Gormley hated their smiles. If the child repulsed him enough, he would place the photo to the side in a special pile. Once he'd whittled his list down to one, he'd read up on the case. When and where the child disappeared, what they were wearing that day, where they'd been spotted since, if they'd been spotted since. He'd research all he could about the child's parents, siblings, if he or she had any pets or participated in any extracurricular activities. He'd even try to learn what the child's favorite color was, if he could. Information like this was valuable to his work, and the internet made things so much easier. It hadn't always been so easy, and used to take him up to a year to get the information he needed to produce one letter. Gormley felt pride in the fact that this year alone, his first year of retirement, He'd been able to produce a very convincing letter every couple of weeks. Thank the good Lord for technology. He singled out a photo, the subject of his latest work, and he regarded it with an obnoxious sneer. The little boy in the picture was nauseatingly happy. He was wearing a cap with an emblem of a cartoon tiger hitting a baseball, and a t-shirt in matching blue and orange. The boy held a small trophy in his hands, and he looked so damned proud of himself. Gormley reclined in his chair and thought of the letter sitting in the mouth of his lonely mailbox.
Dear Mrs. Appleton, your worries are at an end. I'm the man who 4 years and 7 months ago took your boy Trevor from your car whilst you shopped. We sat and watched you return with your gallon of milk before we drove away. You may consider yourself lucky. It did not suffer long, and he remained a virgin. I hope that you have since learned to lock your doors, for men like me are everywhere.
And went on for 4 full pages depicting the most believable abduction, torture, and murder scenario that Gormley could envision, custom detailed for little Trevor Appleton. Gormley was especially proud of the bit about the jar of spiders. He'd learned about the boy's arachnophobia, and such a particularity was too exquisite to omit. In his eyes, Gormley was helping these families get over it all, move on with their lives. He put a stop to their uncertainty. Most of all, he gave them something to hate. And what a great motivator that was. Hate was what got him up and cracking before the sun could show itself. Hate was what had fueled him all of his life. Hatred was what made him exceptional. Other children had been spoiled. They lived under the illusion that somebody cared about them. And if somebody didn't, then at least that somebody should care. Gormley's expression curdled at the very idea. He could almost taste those thoughts of false love and feigned affection gurgling up the back of his throat like bile. And he fought them back by lapping at the dissolving peppermint in his mouth. The whole love thing was a joke. Parents really cared for children as children cared for their toys, as objects of dreams and fantasy, and ultimately disappointment to be broken and forgotten when playtime ended. The amount of love given was only equal to the child's usefulness. Gormley had learned that lesson early in his youth, and it had made him tough and cruel. It had made him exceptional. Because of the remoteness of his property and his disagreeable comportment, Gormley didn't get many visitors. He liked it that way. Often he would go days without seeing anybody at all, except for the postman. And the postman was only ever seen from Gormley's single front window. The postman both excited and disgusted Gormley. His father had been a postman. That fact alone was enough to spawn a black aversion to any and all postal workers. And for years, even long after the old man died, looking at a mail carrier made Gormley ill. Every time he did, he would hear the rusty screech of his father's truck. He would smell the beer-tinged halitosis all over again.
What are you doing, boy? What are you doing? I told you not to touch yourself like that, boy, you nasty little bastard.
He would hear echoes of garbled curses and shouts.
What's wrong with you, boy? Don't you understand?
He would feel the shoves, the slaps, and the punches.
You know what'll happen when you touch that nasty little thing? What's wrong with you?
Before Gormley started his crusade, the postman delivered him nothing but pain. But this, as it turned out, was a blessing in disguise, and Gormley was perceptive enough to see it. Through his work, he'd turned the thing he hated most into his personal lapdog. The postman came almost every day. It was his job to come, and he would take Gormley's letters off and deliver them. He had to every stupid, soft, happy, sappy family. The postman was weak, a sheep, a zombie, an instrument. The postman had no power over Gormley now. It was he who was the puppet master. No, the preacher. No, the savior of the world. And if the world couldn't learn from him, then, as far as Gormley was concerned, it deserved to suffer blindly in darkness. But today, the postman was terribly late, and Gormley was beginning to worry. Maybe the authorities were monitoring his mail. Maybe they were fitting the postman with high-definition cameras and microphones. Gormley hadn't been caught and punished for doing something bad since he was a child. He learned to be careful. Never once had he even received a response from a vengeful, grieving parent. Of course, he never revealed his identity. But you never know how somebody can find you out nowadays. His saliva could have been pulled from all the stamps and envelopes. It could have been collected in a vial in some refrigerated vault somewhere deep below the Pentagon. Perhaps the authorities were just biding time, amassing evidence. Gormley had done nothing really wrong, of course. He'd never killed anybody. He'd never touched any children. Gormley didn't know too much about the law, but whatever they could charge him with, he knew they couldn't just send him to prison, even if they did drag him to trial.
Over what? A few letters? A few hard truths?
He'd have the opportunity to preach his cold gospel to the world.
And the court here intends to prove that this man is responsible for sending these letters to these poor grieving parents.
I haven't done anything wrong. Don't you see? I'm helping these people. I'm helping them. I'm helping them to get over their grief. What have you done to help with their grief? What have you done? What have any of you done for them? I've brought their pain back, yeah. I've made them feel everything. But then I helped them move on to get past it. The filthy smiles, the happiness. They need to get past it, don't you understand? They need to get by it. They need to understand what this world is really about. What demons really lurk in this world.
And his arguments would be so convincing that the lawyers and the judge and the jury and the families in the courtroom, and the journalists, and all the people at home watching on TV would open their collective eyes to reality. Everyone would finally see the real, cold, hard truth. Then, people would start acting accordingly. Then the world and everyone in it would start getting real instead of play-acting in the same sick, tired old farce. Would getting caught really be so bad then? Gormley considered this for a moment. Probably. Probably, yes. People are stupid. They simply wouldn't understand. Gormley couldn't go to prison. He wasn't as tough as he had been in his youth, not physically anyway, and prison was full of men much tougher than he. No, getting caught was out of the question. He'd sooner die. Gormley's stomach ached. Too much caffeine and sugar. Too much worry. He debated walking to the mailbox, taking the letter, and trying again the next day. Perhaps he would write another draft after a short nap. But if he were being watched, retrieving a letter from his mailbox would appear quite suspicious to prying eyes. Would it not? Another thought occurred to him. What if one of the real abductors had learnt of his letters? What if some psychopath child killer was out there lurking in the fog, wearing a bloody postman's uniform and waiting for Gormley to take that long, lonely walk to his mailbox? Surely, at least a few maniacs resented his taking credit for their deeds. Gormley wrung his hands. He scurried to his door to check the locks. His trailer creaked on its cinder block legs. The fog outside had lifted. It had turned from hyperborean gray to dingy yellow. Was it really so late in the day? Gormley swiped his phone from the nightstand. It was dead. He'd checked it not long ago. That's how he was so sure the postman was late, and it had been fully charged. His old desktop didn't fire up either. He pulled the chain on a nearby lamp and no light emerged from behind the shade. It was a blackout. Perhaps they were working on the line somewhere out there. Perhaps it was the police, and in an instant they were going to kick his door down and blast him with tear gas. Or perhaps it was a madman with an axe. Such speculation was no good. It provoked far too much anxiety. Gormley considered the fact that he hadn't actually talked to another human being in a week or two. He'd barely left the trailer, save to check the mail, and his diet had been especially terrible during the time he was focused on his letters. It was the isolation and the caffeine and the lack of sleep making him worry. It was all of that. And the damned postman. Today of all days he was late. It just all felt too inauspicious. Was it getting darker? Gormley pulled a candle from a drawer. It couldn't have been later than 10 a.m. Was his vision failing? Too much time in the dark, in front of a computer screen? He returned to his kitchenette, lit the candle, and placed it on the table in front of him. The world beyond the flame in the solitary window had grown ever darker. It appeared to be dusk, though there was no way of discerning the sun's position in the fog, which had thickened just as quickly as the daylight had waned. It rolled over Gormley's property, obscuring his view of the mailbox and blank sheets of oblivion.
I must be tired.
The phrase repeated itself in his head over and over. His mind and body swung from nervous tension to outright lethargy.
I must be tired. I gotta lie down.
He wasn't sure of what he was telling himself, but he slowly rose to his feet with the candle, reluctantly breaking his gaze on the shrouded world outside. And he shuffled to his room at the opposite end of the trailer. He observed how quiet it was. There was only the groan of his footsteps. There were no birds or furry little things scampering through the trees outside. Even if the day was really over, the usual hum of night insects was strangely absent. It was sound dampening technology. It had to be. They were screwing with him, watching him from the woods. He was almost sure of it. But who were they? Do maniacs have access to the kind of engineering necessary for this sort of production? Gormley banished the thought from his mind. He slipped into his bed and piled the covers around him. It was the police. They were trying to break him. Well, they didn't know whom they were harassing. First thing in the morning, he'd go to town. He'd mail his letter personally. Then he'd go to the police station and confront them. He'd force them to play their hand. And what? Then he'd go to jail? Certainly not. Certainly not that. So what then? Well, he'd think of it. He'd think of something. Perhaps to a lawyer first. Yes, a lawyer. He had options. He wasn't a poor man, and he certainly wasn't a fool. Yes, he'd mail his letter. Then talk to a lawyer, then. But his letter. He'd have to get his letter. He'd have to get out of bed. He'd have to leave his trailer. He'd have to walk that long walk down to the mailbox in the darkness and fog.
I can stay in the box overnight. No harm in that. Just one night. If the postman comes before I'm up, that saves me a trip.
Gormley flopped from one side to the other and faced the wall. The candle's flicker cast odd shadows and stretched his own deformed silhouette across the false wood paneling. His eyes were weighty and felt dry and raw. He'd hoped to end his day in the same manner he always did after a successful missive assault, by fantasizing about some little child's mother or father, opening his envelope and reading his letter. He would imagine the color draining from their faces, the tears welling in their eyes, the wailing and gnashing of teeth. Gormley cursed his anonymity. He wanted the parents to write him back. One time, he had chanced upon the mother of one of his lost children responding on TV to the letter he'd sent. The failure in her words, the stupidity in her voice, it was all so predictably perfect. Gormley had downloaded the video clip from the show and replayed it often when he felt the urge to do impure things. Gormley fell asleep. Swirling dreams rushed through his agitated brain with foggy visions of crying mothers, smiling children, SWAT teams and serial killers, and of course, the postman, his wretched slave.
Make that face at me, boy. I swear to God, I'll break your fucking scrawny little neck. You and your fucking mother's the same. You're just the same. Worthless piece of shit.
He awoke at an unfamiliar time to a hard single knock at his door. His candle had burned itself out, but he could see scant light coming from the kitchenette window at the trailer's opposite end. He sat nervously in a dull room. It was as if he hadn't slept a wink. Another hard, hammering knock at the door. A battering ram? Or worse, an axe? Then Gormley heard something in the silence outside. Someone was moving from the front door to his side of the trailer in excruciatingly slow, plodding steps. There was also a scraping, sliding noise advancing across the metal exterior. Something pressed heavily against the trailer, causing it to sigh like the hull of an ancient ship set adrift in the fog. And Gormley could hear the breathing. The slow, labored breathing of clogged, elderly lungs. The movement stopped just outside of Gormley's bedroom. The wall creaked vaguely, and the breathing grew louder. The visitor outside was listening, pressing their head to the wall. Gormley held his breath. He tightened his blanket against his chest to muffle the sound of his heartbeat. Untold time passed while Gormley sat paralyzed by the croaking rhythm of the breathing outside. Then the panting rose to a furor, and the insidious invisible presence spoke in low, sustained, dripping tones.
Francis Gormley! Come on out here! Got a package for you, boy!
The voice was a mockery of something recognizable. It was glottal and reptilian, conjuring up a pallid but unmistakable memory. Gormley's leaden heart began to sink. He wet himself. And the caffeine was to blame. After a moment, the owner of the voice outside started a slow, creeping limp back toward the front door. Gormley considered barricading it, but he doubted he had time. Whoever it was outside had heavy fists and could have battered the door down with minimal effort. A kitchen knife was the only accessible means of defense. The stranger was almost to the door. Gormley shook free from vacillation and nearly tripped over the blanket as he tore out of his room. His heavy footsteps shook the floor. Just as he passed the threshold, another solid thump on the door froze him in place.
Francis!
The anger in the stranger's voice was palpable.
Get out here, boy! I got deliveries! Can't be out here all damn night!
His final word was punctuated with another powerful knock. The aluminum surface of the door was undoubtedly dented, and Gormley heard the splintering of cheap wood. For the first time since a childhood of drunken words and drunken hands ossified in his memory, despite every attempt to forget, Gormley felt the urge to cry, to scream for help. But who would help him? Gormley tried to speak, and it took more effort than he'd anticipated. His voice came out in cracks and squeaks.
I can't be bothered just now. Come back tomorrow.
The trespasser's heavy gasps mutated into a sickening chuckle.
I'll be back tomorrow to be sure, boy.
Gormley heard the intruder turn and begin to stagger away. Gormley ran to the cutlery drawer and rummaged for the largest knife he could find. It was dreadfully dark outside, and the light that seeped in through the window belonged to a pair of fog lights at the end of the driveway. Gormley squinted and spied the tall, hunched, bleary shape of a man in a rounded postman's hat hobbling back towards the source of the lights. The man was moving so slowly that his lame steps seemed to take place in a kind of bizarre time-lapse photography. Upon reaching the end of the drive, the figure, bathed in the fog lights, turned to Gormley's mailbox and lingered.
Leave! Just leave!
Gormley whispered aggressively. He wanted to repeat himself more loudly and forcefully, but before he could utter them again, the man turned back as though he'd already heard.
I hear you.
At once the fog lights intensified, taking the shape of two huge, bulging, orb-like eyes, and the face of the postman appeared in full view, directly outside the window. The ghastly being curled its thin lips and gaped at him with a riven, rotten-toothed mouth that billowed fog and foul expiration. Mottled yellow-gray skin hung from a skull wreathed in patches of dead, white hair. The postman's fog-light eyes flashed and burned as he let out a protracted scream. Then, the moldy jaws clenched and he ground his jagged teeth together in a hateful, decayed grimace. At that moment, a blinding white sting hit Gormley directly in his eyes. He clutched at his face and fell away from the window, tumbling over the table and back first onto the linoleum floor. Gormley screamed. The razor-thin edge of some spectral blade had slashed deep into each eyeball. His hands were warm and wet with tears and blood and something else. Something thicker. He could feel it oozing down his face and puddling the floor. Pain was excruciating, like the worst paper cut imaginable in the most delicate and sensitive of places. The angry, feculent voice of the postman hissed.
You're gonna lose more than yours, Francis. I'm coming tomorrow, and I'm gonna take your fat little fingers, and then I'll come the next night and take your tongue. I'll split it right down the middle, boy. And then there'll be no more bad words from you.
Postman's horrid laughter resounded inside the trailer. Gormley felt the stinking, humid breath on his face. It was a sickly familiar mixture of soil, stale beer, and rotten fish. Then suddenly, nothing. Silence for what felt like an eternity. At last, Gormley heard the mail truck pull out onto the blacktop road with a rusty screech and slowly drive away, taking the darkness with it. Gormley heard the pleasant sounds of the day, the birds and the furry little animals busying themselves amongst the trees. But Gormley's nightmare remained. Fear overrode the pain in his lacerated eyes. The postman would come back. He was sure of it. And who knew how long the day would last? Time meant nothing now. Gormley had to get out. He had to find people. Perhaps prison wasn't such a bad option. Maybe they'd take pity on a blind man. At the very least, he wouldn't be alone. Gormley pulled himself to his feet and groped for the door. He had to put a shoulder to it to get it to open. And when it did, he tripped over a large object at his feet. He felt that it was a package wrapped in paper. He was afraid to open it, but he shook it and could distinguish the unmistakable rustling of envelopes within. Then the faint sounds of laughing children surrounded him. Gormley's throat felt constricted and sour, and he wished he'd had a peppermint. He picked up the package and, with great trepidation, made his way to the blacktop road at the end of the drive. Gormley pointed himself toward town and wandered off blindly in the vaporous morning fog.